3, 2, 1. I think we're live. Hello, everybody. How are you? And we are live on the YouTube. I am the original gamer, Stevie Stroh. I am joined by a special panel of esteemed guests. And I'm just going to read off the names from left to right as I can see them on my Skype screen right now. So to my far left is John Strong. That's
Yo,
my
dog.
John Strong of Strongware. And then I need somebody to hold on. I'm hearing a feedback in the sound. I'm not sure who's.
That's me. Just a second.
Okay.
I can read the chat in YouTube.
I have John Strong on the left. I have Curtis Boyle in the center. Curtis Boyle of the Color Computers Games List of other fame, as well as being one of the original co-contributors to the Nitrous 9 project. And speaking of Nitrous 9, we also have his partner in crime on that original project. Bill Noble is with us as well. So hello, gentlemen.
Hello.
And we are going to play some color computer games. We're going to talk about the color computer. We'll probably talk about Cocoa Fest and who knows what else we'll talk about. Maybe we'll even find world peace and a cure for global warming while we're at it, if we are feeling really ambitious. So we're also supposed to be joined back in the chat momentarily by Nick Marentes. And I actually have Nick Marentes' game open right now. This is Megan, please stop doing that. This is Nick's conversion of the original Pac-Man arcade game, which we will play. I don't know if I should wait for Nick before we start playing this, or if I should go ahead and, or you want to tell us a little bit about this game, Curtis, based on your...
Yeah, I mean, I can tell you, he did it as an unofficial port, unlike Donkey Kong by Sockmaster. He did not, you know, reverse engineer the ROMs and use it. He actually reprogrammed it, you know, on his own, the algorithms for the Ghost. He didn't watch the game. He did digitize some of the sounds from the original game, but basically it's his own creation.
Okay, so this is a rewrite. It's not an emulation or anything else. And so far, it's looking pretty good.
It's hard to tell once you start playing.
I'm sure. Very cool. So I guess I'll go ahead and fire it up. And while I'm going to sit here and play this game, we can talk about anything else that tickles our fancy.
And this has all the intermission scenes and stuff too, by the way.
Okay.
Set up to make it that far.
It's telling me to press the joystick button to play, but I think it's the keyboard button. Okay, there's the music. Okay, so, oh, I like it. I like the colors. I like the sounds. So far, there's pretty much nothing not to like about this game.
Yeah, you'd be hard-pressed to swear that you're not playing it on MAME at the moment.
Yeah. And there's our cherries.
Well, Nick does just a good job. I did it. We met for the last YouTube session that I did an interview with Neil and John Linville, the CoCo broadcast, and I was mentioning some other current game programmers, and I didn't mention Nick about himself as good because you just assume that it's coming from Nick is good.
Right. This is an amazing. Oh, there we go. We have the blue ghosts. Yeah, I mean, and the sounds are. They're not in a literal sample, but they're very, you know what they are, but they're also, they seem a little bit original, you know, because it's like a definitely
Nick
a
just came
slight,
back. I just saw him.
Okay, is Nick back in the, okay, yeah. Nick is back. Nick, we're here and we're playing Pac-Man. Perfect timing. I just started playing. Oh, and I just died. Very cool. So let's try it again. Yeah, I like it.
Can you add another Skype call?
I would like to add Nick to the Skype call. I don't remember what Nick's final verdict was on Skype.
Well, we did an experiment between us when he was showing me a preview of Popstar Pilot earlier today, so
okay.
It seemed to work okay.
All right, so yeah, Nick, I would need to have you send me a friend request. I would add you as a contact, and then I can bring you into the call. Okay, I have too many windows open right now. So hopefully that will flash. Hold on. Okay, so Ed's here. I don't know if Ed wants to join the Skype call. Yes, I could. Okay, let's add Ed. Just tuning in. All right. Well, the Skype call is getting more crowded. Let's see if Ed makes his way in here. All right. I'm with too many windows open here. Okay. I hate my face on Skype. Besides, I haven't put on my makeup, he says. Well, you could just do a voice. You could just not use your camera.
Yeah, Bill's just doing
that. Yeah, that's what I'm doing, Nick, so you can do it.
Okay. I hate my face on Skype. Besides, I haven't put on my makeup.
I'm hearing myself twice again.
Well, you can just do a voice. You can just not use your camera.
I'm not sure who's causing the sound.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing next.
Ed, are you there?
I hate my face on Skype. Besides, I haven't put on my makeup.
I'm hearing myself twice again.
Well, you can just do a...
Okay, that might have been Ed. I'm not sure who's causing the echo right now.
I think it was Ed. He just hung up and now it stopped.
Okay.
You guys turn off your YouTube.
Nick's going to do it in voice, so.
Okay, Nick's going to do it in voice. Gotcha. Yeah, it's very difficult trying to manage all these Skype windows right now. So let's see if I can get an IM from Nick.
You guys turn off your YouTube.
Nick's going to do it in voice, so.
Who's doing that now? Now I'm hearing it again.
Hello.
Yeah, it's very difficult trying to manage.
Ed, are you there?
Right, yes, now. I'm there.
Hey, how are you? Welcome to the Skype call. I think you're causing sound looping on us right now. Can you put on headphones by any chance so we don't, your mic doesn't pick up the speakers?
Hello.
It's very difficult to hear. Matt, are you there?
Yes,
I'm there. Hey, how are you? Welcome to the Skype call.
Hello, thanks for adding me.
Sound looping on us right now. Can you put on headphones by any chance so we don't?
I'll go grab some.
Okay, I'm gonna hang up on you until you get that back and call back. Okay. Or maybe he did. I don't know what he did. All right. Where do I do an IM? Okay, here's Nick. Yeah, Nick, send me a friend request on Skype. It's OG Stevie Stroh. I am trying to get my Skype windows going here, and there's so many Skype windows right now, I can't even see them all.
You're beginning to feel like twit.
Yes. Oh, I always feel like a twit. Now, did I lose all my Skypes?
Can you hear me still?
Yes.
Well, I should be still here too, Steve.
Yeah, Bill, you're here.
John, you can hear us?
Yep.
Yeah, I can hear fine.
Okay. We'll get the technical part worked out. Now I'm just waiting to see if I can get Nick to send me a let me see if I can find Nick. I'll see if I can find Nick. Marentes?
Yep, and Nickolas is what he goes under, Nicholas.
Nicho.
Is it K? Is it K or H? On the screen on Pac-Man, it's K.
I am going to search.
I'm looking at, I talked to him on Skype earlier, and his Skype is...
Okay.
So it's Nicholas.
And then is Marentes.
Okay, it's probably the one from Brisbane, Australia, right?
Quite like
that.
All right, so I'm sending him a friend request right now. Let's see if he will accept me. And then we can bring him into the call, and then we can play Pac-Man. Okay, here he goes. He's saying, frickin' Skype. All right, so we're working on a couple technical glitches, but Nickolas has shared contact details. All right, so Nickolas says he's online.
I was just going to suggest to Nick that maybe that Skype was written in Noah's 9.
Add to group call. Okay, we are trying to get Nick in here. Nick, it is completely up to you. Hello, Meowser, how are you? It is up to you as to whether or not you want to wear makeup or put on a wig or be on camera or off camera. It is, completely your call, but I do need everybody to be on headphones so I don't hear the sound loop back. Yes, see, I'm hearing myself again.
Yeah, Nick, do you have headphones?
Okay, thank you, Megan. But we're getting these calls together here, slowly but surely. I feel like a telephone operator right now. I'm just patching everybody in. Hello?
Yeah.
And I don't know what happened to Ed. I'm sorry, John, I talked over you. What did you say?
I just want to say hello, this is the operator.
Yes, hello, this is the operator speaking. How may I connect your call?
Skype lady.
Alright, Ed's back.
Yes.
How are you, Ed?
I'm fine, how about yourself?
Very good, you're also up in the Great White North, as Curtis is.
It's not very white up here right now. It's like 50 degrees.
Yeah, well, I'm basically the same area. And
very good. You're also up in the Great White North.
Okay, somebody's right? Still doubling up my sound. So who's...
It's not very white up here right now. Is that Nick? Are you running open air?
No, I've got headphones on.
Oh, hello, Nick. I just finally...
You can hear me?
I can hear you, Nick, yeah. Ed, do you have headphones on?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so...
Is it maybe Steve?
Who's saying that? Bill or
Bill? Yeah.
Do you have? Are you on headphones?
I'm on headphones. Yeah.
Okay. Can you mute the volume if you have the YouTube channel open too? Just mute the volume on YouTube itself.
Oh, I don't even have it open.
Oh, okay.
Bill? Yeah.
I'm not sure where the echo is coming from.
I've muted my YouTube channel.
Okay, perfect. That might be it.
I hear the Australian accent.
Yeah. Hello, Nick. How are you?
G'day.
Good day. It is a pleasure to speak to you, and I'm looking forward to playing many more of your games. And so we have Pac-Man open. Thank you for allowing us to have access to this wonderful piece of software.
Okay.
And I'm going to go ahead and play it.
Yeah. And Nick, if you want to kind of talk over and maybe talk about the development of it a little bit, obviously no more brought to the rest of us, too.
All right. So here I go. Pac-Man, classic game. I figured everyone would like Pac-Man, so I decided to do Pac-Man. I think it was in 1999. I did it just before the Pinfest. Just before the 1999 Pinfest. It was done during an era before the emulators, or before I had the emulators. So much of the graphics and much of the sound was all created with, just walking down to an arcade and just recording it.
Wow,
and
that's
just
impressive.
So nowadays, of course, you can just take snapshots of the actual emulated game on the PC. But back then, it was a bit harder. So one thing I really wanted to do is to get the look and feel of the original game. I wanted to make sure that it ran at 60 frames per second, and I tried to make the ghost movement to be faithful to the original arcade game. Nowadays you can go on the net and find the actual algorithm for the ghost intelligence,
okay.
But back then I didn't. So I just had to look at the original game, see how they actually... worked or how they thought on the screen, and come up with an algorithm that sort of looked the same. And I think the end result looks pretty good. Most people think it's the same algorithm, but it's completely different. Although, having now read what the algorithm really is, it's surprising I've used a lot of the techniques that they did. So it comes out fairly well.
Great minds think alike.
Well, yeah, theirs is great. Mine is not so great. it's been a popular game. Pac-Man is one of those games which are gender free. So you can find young children, girls, women, whatever, enjoying it just as much as your hardcore male arcade gamer.
Right, true, very
which,
true.
Which is why it was popular in the arcades. Fairly non-violent, if you want to call a pizza-looking object violent-eating ghost stuff.
Right.
That's about as violent as it gets. What else?
Well, let me ask you a question about the sound itself, because I love the sound. I don't know, it's not, is the sound sampled, or did you just recreate it to the best of your recollection?
It's sampled by recording onto cassette from a real machine. Sitting there with a microphone and a cassette recorder, recording the actual game and getting all the main sounds, and then sampled on a color computer using StudioWorks from Oblique Triad, I believe. And then just basically massaging it into the game. So it's fairly accurate.
The thing I notice about it is
The intermissions as well.
I know it sounds great. It's because to me it sounds like It sounds like somebody heard a song and said, okay, well, we're going to play the same song, but we're going to play it a little tiny bit different and make it our own. You know, that's kind of how I can, because it's not like, it's not a completely, well, again, this is my ears interpreting this, but yeah, to me, it sounded like you just, kind of like you did the algorithms yourself, it sounded like you did the sound yourself too and just made a very personalized version of it. But no, it's very cool.
Yeah.
It's hard to believe how popular this game was. It was 1981. You know, like you say, it's a circle face eating dots.
Yeah.
But it is so immensely popular.
I think it created a coin shortage in Japan or something, didn't it?
It did. That's Space Invaders.
I wouldn't doubt it. And do you remember the soundtrack? Somebody made a soundtrack called Pac-Man Fever.
Yeah,
they made a song. I actually have that on vinyl somewhere. I've got to dig that up.
I've got the CD, Buckner and Garcia.
Yeah, yeah. And that was the big hit was the Pac-Man Fever. But there were some lesser successful hits like Do the Donkey Kong and things like that. Yeah. I have the vinyl album of that somewhere. But yeah, Pac-Man was so influential for its time. And I think you touched on that there. It's genderless.
And I think Nick did an actual pretty darn good job of that.
Oh yeah, no doubt. I'm sitting here playing it up while we're talking, and I could play this all day.
Of course, the original machine ran the screen vertically, so it used the longer edge of the tube monitor, of course, to get the height. Of course, we can't do that on the color computer unless you want to turn the screen around. So I've gone for the maximum height I can get and made the score and high score and all that on the sides. Yeah,
that makes sense.
So it keeps it roughly looking right. I mean, the original machine is much more taller and narrower, but that was about the best compromise I could do at the time.
Yeah. So do you actually have roughly the same amount of dots on the actual screen then?
Yeah, 52, I think it is.
Wow, it's fun! It's fun to play.
Think you can make an intermission there, Steve?
I don't know. I keep dying. I'm trying to clear one round here. It's bloody difficult.
The high score on this is some. I think I still hold the high score on this one, and I can't remember if it was in the 30. Or did I get up to the 50,000s? I can't remember.
Wow.
But it's pretty full on to get to that height. the ghosts do get faster and get more cunning as time goes on, just like in the original. I don't know if it's the same algorithm, but it still feels the same.
It does. It plays well. You know, so one of the more, I think, higher quality ones of the time was probably like the Atari 800 version. And that one, they had to make compromises and do the screen wide rather than tall for all the reasons that you mentioned, just the differences in the television screens. But yeah, this is really good. I like the colors. I like the sounds. I like everything about it. I might actually clear one round here. Wow. Praise be for small miracles here. All right. I did. I cleared one. Oh, crap. I died on the last freaking dot.
I think you can get the
bottom. I was robbed. I demand a recount.
There you go.
Ooh, that's I got robbed like a Florida election right there. That was
there you go.
Oh man.
I think if I remember correctly, this uses the 320x225 mode to get as much.
I think I did use the highest again to get the maximum height out of it. Yeah. It's a very underutilized. It's not a special mode, but 225 is a mode that's standard for the Gibby chip, but not many programs use it, and I'm a big fan of it.
I think part of the reason for that, though, if I remember, some certain TVs wouldn't actually show it all, like you'd lose part of the bottom or something.
I don't know. I thought it was more that Tandy wanted to keep the 192 vertical res the same as the old color computer, so I just assumed they just carried it over. It always worked on every TV I had seen it on, so I don't know.
I have seen it on one or two that it did not. It actually cut the bottom of four lines.
Oh, right, yeah. I haven't seen that problem as such.
Yeah, there was some reports to some of the people that I knew on, so that there's
some problems on some monitors with the highest vertical resolution.
I've always had a CM8 on the color computer 3, and it's never been a problem. I think what happens is that the standard color the green text VDG mode is smaller. It does, like, it has very big black borders. So maybe people have just enlarged the screen to enlarge that screen up. But when I run these, when you go to graphics, of course it's too big now. I don't know.
And Steve here, since we've got several game authors on board here, do you want to alternate between their games?
Yes, that's what I was looking for right now. So I'm looking for so for the ROM file, I have to load that as a cartridge on my emulator?
Yeah, you can load it as a cartridge, or if you double-click on it, if you're set up properly, it'll start it.
All right, so I'm going to try that. I'm going to go back. I'm going to switch to a ROM file now, and I want to take a look at Bomb Squad. I want to make sure I refer to the name properly. B Squad ROM.
Okay. John, have you actually shown the packaging and stuff on the live stream since we started?
Oh, no, I have not yet. Okay, so this is the 3D printed cartridge.
Very nice.
Okay. This is the box. Preliminary working on design for the manual to go inside.
I like that.
Okay, and now we're going to feel all inferior after seeing Nick's great Pac-Man game.
I like the title screen here. All right, so we're looking at John Strong's Bomb Squad. This is not the final version, but it's close to what you're going to be providing at CoCo Fest.
Nick just used the high-res routines you guys developed.
It's nicely drawn. Nicely drawn graphics, yeah.
Oh, I see that I am using. Do I just click on start now? I stick on.
Yeah, click on start.
Oh, I'm actually moving a mouse on the CoCo.
Yes.
So this is Minesweeper.
Yeah, yes. John, does this support the new high res mode that Sockmaster Nick discovers?
Yes, that's what it's using.
Okay, now. I was never a master at Minesweeper. I know when you see the number one, that means there's going to be a flag. It's one square away from that, right?
Yeah.
I always had a hard time interpreting that. So, and then how would you? Can you flag the ones that are safe too with the right click?
Yes.
Now I don't know the logic here, but I think then that should be safe there. Let's move around. So yeah, because I'm using a PC joystick here, it's a little bit. Kind of spring centering here. It's messing with me a bit, but this is cool.
Well, and the fact that you're running on the emulator is going to mess with you because on the emulator, it's only going to give you 64 positions out of that. It takes a real crack of get to for this move smooth.
Yeah, I've noticed that a lot too, John, myself.
Bummer. Bummer. Yeah, so, and I know, Nick, you had mentioned in one of your comments that I should point a camera. Oh, hello, Psy Pikachu. Hello. So can I point a camera at a CoCo? I can definitely do that. But if I do that, I can't do things like this with the live stream. So in order for me to be able to composite all these feeds, I have to use my software, and that rules out pointing a camera. So I will do future videos where I'll point a camera at the CoCo. But for the sake of this weekend, that's not a practical solution for me. But I do want to get over the limitations of emulation and things like that. I'm still working on a long-term solution for that. How do I reset the game? Do I click on the face?
Yes, just click there on the face.
Okay, this is very cool. This is very, very cool. Do you have options to make the field bigger and things like that too?
Yes, okay.
Because I think I picked the wimpy level when I started the game.
Yeah. Hit Q.
Hit Q to quit? Okay.
Okay, so. And go down the arrow keys. The arrows beside the rookie on both sides.
Uh-huh.
And to the right, we'll go up a level.
Officer, huh? And here's your RGB and composite. I see that. Very cool. I like the packaging that you showed, too, the multicolored cartridge. It's a nice package. I'm looking forward to buying some cartridges at CoCo Fest, man. I really am. It's going to be cool.
And, this is just, it's a bit differently. And it was actually a game I didn't know I was going to release until Nick released the high-res joystick, and I thought, well, that'd fit right fine into it. And so I redid the graphics.
Oh, bummer.
Allowed to do the smaller square sizes and to give more levels of gameplay with it. And decided, okay, that's going to look nice enough to actually release.
And yeah, I like it. Wow, man, I'm doing really bad.
And so it has high score screens. If you win, it'll come up and show you that. If you go back to the main screen, it gives you overall performance report.
Okay.
And that'll show you the high scores on the different levels.
Okay. I like the fonts. The fonts are very cool looking.
The fonts was actually designed originally on a color computer. I have a font editor that I wrote years ago. It's one of my bold font that I did with that. And now I wrote some routines to do the graphic, the text effects.
That's very neat. Yeah, I think I'm better off staying on the training wheels level. I can't handle the deep end of the pool apparently without my water wings. So I will go ahead and stay down here. Oh, bombing. This is very cool though. I mean, it is
probably the hardest level. I want to see how many squares are on that one.
The hardest level? Okay, Steve Batson says this is cool. Let's try it. Let's try the super hard level. Let's see how big the grid is. Okay.
And so I took it and kind of thought, well, I want a little different than Minesweeper. So I thought, okay, well, you know, Minesweeper, you're just fine. Well, let's take it to Bomb Squad Officer. Okay?
Holy crap. All right, we got a full screen here now. We have a full bleeding screen.
Yeah, you know, it's another one of those classics that, you know, I kind of thought we needed a full version of.
Yeah.
And we've got some versions out there. The ones I've seen just doesn't do the multiple screens and stuff.
Oh, my God. This is horrible. Well, I'm horrible. Let me be specific here. This is cool, though. I like it. So
I do a countdown instead of a count up. And that's the part I don't have finished or what I'm going to do when you run out of time.
Okay.
And that's not going to be a real big job. I don't think I'm going to do anything really fancy on that. But I do want to do a little bit more than what I've got in it right now.
I wonder how many people have actually beat this game. I think this is one of those games that you play it and you give up. Have you really?
Yeah. I have never beaten Mine Squad or even any other form.
Wow. It's neat, though. I like it. I like the look and feel of it. It's amazing to me how well people are taking the 16 colors of the CoCo 3 and just really making things look amazing with those colors. Because even in 86 when it came out, 16 colors was not a lot compared to contemporary systems. So it always seems like we were a little bit behind the curve on features. And there were definitely more colorful systems out by the time the CoCo 3 was released.
Yeah, because the CoCo 3 basically is the equivalent of an EGA card with lower resolution.
Yeah.
64 colors to choose from, 16 color palettes. But we would go up to 320 by 225 versus 640 by 350 for EJ.
But I think there's just something about the CoCo producers, the people who produce stuff, that they always know a way to not look at the limitations and look at the potential and just tap into that potential, you know? Because everything I've seen using only 16 colors has blown me away. I just know how vivid it's looked. Like those games we played earlier where the explosions just kept, you know, palette cycling and all that stuff, it was very, very vivid. I like it. I like it a lot. Now, did you also send me the Soviet bloc? I don't remember because I didn't have that earlier.
No, I didn't send you Soviet bloc.
Okay.
There's a demo of it available. I didn't think about it.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. I would like to show a few more things. So let's take a look at another game, though. I like this, though. I could sit here and play this. I can get stuck into playing this game. I become a moth to a flame. So let me go ahead and reset the CoCo, and let's pick another title.
You know, puzzles games are not for everybody, you know. But if you like that, I think it's a good version of it.
Yeah. No, I'm looking forward to seeing it. There's so, like, when it comes to the CoCo 3, there's so many things I haven't seen. So this is all new to me. I'm like a kid in a candy store right now. So I'm going to go ahead and pull up another game. I got all kinds of new stuff today. So let's go back one and let me do a search. And then
you going to go just, to another John game or to a Nick game?
You guys tell me. I'm at your disposal here.
Since we got the authors here, I figure we might as well stick with theirs. So.
Sure.
So oh, yeah, for sure.
Nick, okay. Which one of yours would you like to see next?
Oh, I've seen them all. I don't know. Well, you've seen Pac-Man. You saw Gatecrasher earlier.
I like that Gatecrasher.
How about Cosmic
really
Ambush?
Well, you can do that. Oh. Have you got that one there?
I believe I do. We're
you can always try my latest one, Popstar Pilot. I've got it here running at the moment.
Oh, can we switch to to your view?
Well, we could try that. Well, I don't know how it'll come across. If I point the Skype camera at the CoCo, we might be able to get a picture across. If you want to just bear with me.
If you do that, then I'll make your window full screen when that happens.
Yeah, all right then. All right, give me a sec.
If we're lucky, he might sneak on camera. You can actually see him.
He doesn't have makeup on. Just cover your eyes.
That's right. I don't go on TV without makeup.
Well, you can't be any worse than me, Nick.
So in the Skype call, we have John Strong of Strongware, Curtis Boyle. We have Bill Noble. We have Ed. How do you pronounce your last name?
Sherbinski.
I knew I was going to screw that up. So. And then we have Nickolas Marentes, and here we go. Here's Popstar Pilot. I see it. So let me do this. Let me
the other game first. I'll get everything all aligned.
Okay. I got you maximized. I'll be right back. One second. Oh, that looks good. That looks really good.
I don't know if you can see it.
I can see it fine. Yeah.
All right. You can't. It's looking blurry for me, but that's Ambush. well, have a look at Ambush first, and I'll just try.
Okay, no problem. I'm going to keep that on the screen. Hold on, I got to close this door real quick. Be right back.
The wonders of doing a show live.
And Nick, I want to put you on the spot. I said earlier. That's on another interview on the Coco Crew podcast. I didn't mention your name about upcoming games. And the reason for it is we just assumed that all your games were going to be great.
Sorry?
I said I didn't mention you in another interview.
Oh. About,
and the reason for that, we'd mentioned people that people didn't know and the games were looking good. And I thought, well, I didn't mention Nick because, you know, I just expect his stuff to be great.
Yeah, that's all right. Thanks.
All right, I've got to reboot my VCC. That's the one downside to doing this.
I can show Popstar in the meantime, then.
Yeah. Well, while you're going, I'm going to just tell you a bit about Cosmic Ambush, I suppose. Cosmic Ambush was my first attempt at trying to do a 32K ROM game. It came right after my DigiScan video digitizer, which was a hardware product, and I was hoping maybe I can get back into a bit of software. And this was just before Tandy discontinued the Color Computer 3. So I thought, okay, I'll design it so it will fit into a 32K cartridge. And I had all these wonderful ideas on how to, you know, do the special effects and try to make it the best shoot 'em up that ever come out of for the Color Computer 3. But halfway through, wouldn't you know it, Tandy discontinued the Color Computer 3. And I thought my chances of ever getting Tandy to market this game, especially as a ROM pack, were gone. And basically I gave up on it and just shelved it. It wasn't until a friend of mine who knew that I had been working on it, decided to come over one day, and he asked me, he says, how's your Cosmic Ambush going? And I told him, well, it's been shelved. And he said, you know, he was surprised and said, oh, look, you should just release it. So in the end, I decided to release it as shareware, just as is, without all the other bells and whistles I had planned. There was a plan for a background starscape. There was plans for a few more aliens and flight patterns that they'd have and all that. But none of that, of course, eventuated. So I just packaged it up as is and left it on shareware. So it's a shareware title.
Okay.
I think only one copy actually ever got sold as shareware anyway. So that said a lot for shareware. And that's it. That's the story. It had dreams of being greater, but didn't go that way.
Yeah, I'm having a hard time getting the VCC to even recognize my joystick buttons right now. So I don't think I'm going to be able to even play it. So,
if you turn the keyboard emulation for joystick, does it?
The problem is there's some glitch in my system right now. Anytime I try to change any setting, it automatically causes it to freeze. So I can't really mess with it. I'll just watch it here. Does it get into like a game over or track mode in a minute?
It has an
attack. It does.
Okay, so we'll watch that because it looks marvelous. Okay, top 10.
And this is kind of a Xevious clone, isn't it?
Yes, it was modeled on the Amiga's, the inspiration, I should say. It was more on the Amiga's, is it Xevious on the Amiga? Xenon. On the Amiga. Go.
It looks really good.
Even the ship looks the same as Arcade Xenon.
I like it. I like how the little tip of it spins around. It's like rotating.
Yeah, well, that's what the Amiga one did, so I thought I'd copy it.
Okay.
And it does have power-ups. You can get multiple shots.
If you can hit some of the power-ups, which are the, I think, the W symbols, it'll come down later. I can't see it very well on my screen here at all, so I'm just guessing. There's some symbols that come down which have a W. You get those, you can get multi-fire, a few other little power-ups to help you get through the game. Currently, yeah. there's about three different enemies. Not a lot of flight waves to choose from. But the plan was that they would do, Galaga-like spirals and stuff, but okay. I never got to that. And the idea was the Starscape was supposed to sit in the background to that background, to okay. the current blue, so okay. it gave a bit of a parallax look.
But, gotcha.
Then didn't get that far. 92, that's about the year that Tandy hacks the Color Computer 3, if you close notice.
92, huh?
Yeah.
I am liking what I see for your Popstar Pilot a track screen. That's very nice.
We can put it on, I suppose. I don't know if you can see it in much detail.
Yeah, I'm going to make it bigger. I'm going to make you bigger. So you are now full screen right now. So what we're looking at right now is a world debut. I don't know if it's a world debut, but it's a debut for me anyways.
Yeah, it is actually a debut, isn't it? Yeah. Okay.
Well, this is actually the first time I'm seeing it, Nick.
Well, that's just right. Well, Popstar Pilot, if those of you have been following the blog would sort of know the story. It's been going for a while. It's a sort of project I do in the background whenever I have free time, whenever I'm not working, whenever I'm not doing this and that, of course. So it's a slow process. But anyway, it's getting close to the end now. You're a pilot. You fly a little yellow propeller plane. And basically, I've aimed for a non-violent game, although you do have a gun and you shoot things. You basically go from the start to the end, and as you go, you collect points by hitting balloons. So the name Popstar Pilot, at first you would think has something to do with music,
right?
But it's sort of a cliche. You're a star of popping things, I suppose. Popping balloons. You're a star of popping balloons. So hence, pop star.
That's pilot. Cool.
Yeah. But to give you
a hug. Okay. Love you, Megan.
So that's the idea of a pop star pilot. The game itself will feature when it's done. At least 80 screens is what I've calculated. I've allocated a block of memory of which 80 screens is what it will hold. The demo I've got at the moment is just 10 screens. I'm just randomly put together just so I can test it. So it repeats over and over the the 10 screens. But the final game will have 80, and I'm tossing up whether to double that as well. But
wow.
I'll get 80 done first. Part of the charm is that you sort of fly from left to right, similar to the game Scramble. If you read my blog, you'd find that that Scramble was an initial inspiration for the game.
Okay.
And I've sort of started with that and then just changed it as I went to the point where I can now sort of say it's an original game. And I do that quite often with a lot of my original games. So you fly from left to right. There's no bombing like in Scrambler. I left that out. I've just decided to go with popping balloons, and I've tried to make it challenging in that it's not just about shooting balloons. It's also about surviving the whole journey from A to B, finding out how to get through. There'll be some puzzle caverns that you've got to enter and somehow get out of. There'll be some screens which will actually have two tracks in them, like a top half and a bottom half. If you enter the top half of bonuses, if you enter the bottom, you get different bonuses or different pathway. There are warp that will be that active yet, but there will be warps that shoot, which
hey, you're breaking up us in a little tiny bit, Nick.
Oh, yeah.
Nick, we're losing your audio.
Okay, hang on. How am I going?
Your audio's a little choppy.
I think your bandwidth dropped. I'll
switch to the
computer. Yeah, that's what it sounds like.
Am I any better now? Can you see this? No, the screen is stopped, hasn't it?
The screen's kind of coming and going.
Okay. Well, I'll start the game.
Okay.
And just watch and go from there.
Yeah. I think we definitely got a network congestion thing going on right now, because even your picture became very pixelated. I blame it on the two Canadians we have in a Skype call right now.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Steve.
It's the Canadian rate of exchange that really eats up the data.
Electrons move faster in sub-zero temperatures.
It's the snow from Quebec City.
Yeah. Actually, there's three Canadians. I don't know. Where are you at, Bill? Where's Bill at?
I'm in Humboldt, Saskatchewan, Canada.
Oh, so we have three Canadians in here.
Yep.
Okay.
What I might do is I might just start the move again.
Okay.
The
picture's slowly coming into focus.
My bandwidth is being sucked.
Oh, by the way, when I was playing your earlier game, Steve Batson said that spaceship looked like R2-D2 with wings. That's a pretty good analogy.
It's slowing right down, isn't it?
The picture's coming a little bit better.
I'm going to start it. It hasn't changed.
Maybe the rest of us who have cameras, we can turn off our cameras. Just click on the little camera icon so it's got a little slash through it, and that'll maybe save some bandwidth for momentarily until we can get a cleaner picture on this. Okay, I like the tunnels here. That looks cool. Okay, now I see you've got this little... Okay.
Okay, I've killed the stream on my end, so I'm just going by the... I had two computers on, so I don't know if that was hitting it. Anyway, can you see the propeller plane?
We can see it. It's a little bit blurry, but I can see the motion.
Might take a bit of Skype to readjust, too.
Thank you.
Hello, Olivia. How are you? And so Eddie says, thanks for including me in this session. It's giving me more motivation to improve my programming skills. Okay, I like the sound effects. It almost sounded like a sounded like a grandfather clock for a little while there.
Okay, yeah. All right, I won't say. Yeah, I don't remember recording that one, but yeah.
Did you use the similar tape recorder method on the grandfather clock? This looks good.
This one was taken with, off the internet off WAV files. So you can see it's looped over now.
Okay. It looks cool.
Anyway, it's a bit hard to see when it's all blurry.
Yeah. But we get the idea. I think it looks good.
I can change the background so it's not blue. It's a gradient color now. Can you
okay.
see that?
Yeah, I see that.
So I've got various backgrounds I can set for the different parts of the game itself.
Okay.
So that's a gradient background.
Actually, that gradient looks pretty good, Nick.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, it's not bad. This is an animated one whereby the sky is flashing to indicate lightning. And you can see some water in the bottom there on the screens. As waves. Oops, hang on. Okay. So the idea is avoid the water.
Okay.
You may need to go down to get an object. So it just adds a bit of an obstacle. All that is one color, by the way. It's not actually, not even there. I can just zip under there quickly before the water comes up. I'll just get some fuel, because if you run out of fuel, your plane falls out of the sky. And lastly, I've got this sort of a gradient background as well, which is a more sci-fi type theme, which will come up for up into the later rounds. The graphics don't really suit that. It's for later on. This is just a test version that I just muck around with.
Yeah, it looks good.
Oops, I crashed.
The picture is getting sharper now, too, so I think the bandwidth's clearing up, yeah.
Okay.
Your audio just cleared up, and the picture is a lot clearer now, too.
Yeah. It must have been a bandwidth problem. Yeah. Okay, well, so the idea of here, it gives a bit of a parallax look. So when I go down, it goes up. When I go up, it goes down.
Yeah, I like that.
At the moment, I'm on single shot. If I want multi-shot, I have to hit a red balloon like that one. And now I've got multi-shot, which is much easier.
Is that temporary, or is that until you collide?
20 shots. You're allowed 20 shots, and then it resets. But there's plenty of balloons to... Oh, hang on. I'm dead. There's plenty of red balloons to get. It's really a matter of which balloon do you get. The white balloons give you a 200 point... They're 10 points each, but if you get six of them in a row... you get a 200-point bonus. So it all depends on what you want to chase. All the while, you need to keep an eye on your fuel. If the fuel goes to zero, you end up falling out of the sky, basically. There's a small propeller on the plane. I don't know if you can see it on that.
No, that's a little hard to see.
Yeah, that the propeller looks like it's spinning. And okay. The eyes on the pilot look up or down depending on whether I'm flying up or down as well. So he's a bit animated. The green balloons give you a few more points. I don't know what else I can do with the green balloons, but as I think of things, I'll add them in there. So basically, it's one big survival run from A to B, collecting as many points as you go. And just working out the correct route to get to the end. Once you get to the end, it just loops over. And that's why I'm also thinking of maybe I should put in another 80 screens.
Wow, yeah. that's an impressive number of levels
so far.
What I know this is probably maybe a too early of a question to ask, but would you ever get to the point where you would? Would you release a level editor at some point in time where people could customize this?
I have got a level editor. That's what I use for designing the levels, of course. And it's written in BASIC, so it's not bad. But if I was to release a level editor, I'd try to add some machine code in just to make it a bit faster. At the moment, it's just a tool that I use for designing the levels. So I spoke to Curtis about that. So that's a possibility.
That would be cool.
That would be very cool.
That'd be like a nice bonus content, you know, where
I can always release that later, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's cool though. That's quite impressive.
It's sort of taking a lot of the tricks from the Amiga. I've got an Amiga right next to my current color computer, and that's just sitting. If I turn this, there's the Amiga right next to my CoCo. I look at the games on that, and some of the hardware features that the Amiga could do. Now, the color computer doesn't have all the fancy custom chips that the Amiga has, but we do have the power of the 6809. We do have fairly good interrupt handling. And so I have managed to sneak in some of that Amiga-like stuff by creating machine language interrupt-driven routines that allow me to simulate some of those features to an extent. So in a way, like this title screen you're looking at now, it's got the title and all the text sitting there in the foreground.
Right.
But in the background is that blue checkerboard in the background scrolling separately upwards.
Right.
It almost looks like two bit planes and the back ones are being rolled. On the Amiga, you do have two bit planes, so that would be easy to do on an Amiga. On a color computer, you don't. So I've been using tricks to change the palette to give the effect of a second bit plane in the background.
Okay.
And animating that. So it looks like two bit planes. So that's one. Sorry.
So it's kind of like a simulated frame buffer.
Sort of. Yeah. Yeah. Sort of. It's actually all one color. It's all blue. But I'm changing the palette at the right time and creating that animation from that one color. Hence why the rest of it's not moving. Hence why the red color cycling in the title can just happen without being touched. I'm trying to make it Amiga-like as best I can.
Yeah, it's impressive.
So, it looks like you're changing as on the scan line then.
Yeah, it's at a scan line. Each scan line is being manipulated. Yeah, that's right. So it gives the illusion of being a second bit plane. So the same effect as the Amiga, but done differently. The game itself as well uses a hardware scrolling, which on the GIMI chip, is only 2 bytes at a time. It scrolls 2 bytes at a time, which for this game I thought was too fast. If you scroll 2 bytes fast enough, it does look smooth, like in that Crystal City game. That looks good. But when you slow it down, it looks rough. You can actually see the two byte scroll. So I've actually created I'm utilizing the hardware scroll and the dual buffer as a dual buffer frame buffer together to simulate a 1 byte scroll. 1 byte is 2 pixels. So that allowed me to scroll at a slower rate and still be smooth, like in the game itself. When I start the game, it scrolls very smoothly. It's 2 pixels at a time, and it's all hardware. I'll just switch to this. I'm not moving any of that data on the screen at all. That's just static. Once it draws it on the right-hand edge, that's it. It forgets about it.
the hardware is doing the rest.
Wow.
But another big feature is that the top part of the screen and the bottom part of the screen do not scroll. Now, that's also some interrupt tricks whereby I count the scan lines. If I'm at the top of the screen, I set the scrolling to be zero. So in other words, I stop the hardware scroll, but then I count a certain number of scan lines to turn it back on at the right time for the main game screen. And then I turn it back off again right at the very bottom. So in essence, I've created a split screen scrolling, which is not new. I don't say that I invented it. I know John Kowalski had this sort of used the same technique when he did his Moon Scout and was doing parallax. He was changing the scrolling at different points of the game. So I've done that in this game. What else? The whole background, the coloured background effects simulate the Amiga's copper effect. What they call a copper effect, whereby the scan lines are being changed in real time, even though I'm only manipulating one color, similar to what I'm doing now with this title screen in the game. I'm doing it while the game's playing and creating the gradient blues or the lightning effects or those moving bars. They're all actually one color.
Okay.
So that's just one. That's all black, you could say.
Uh-huh.
But I'm changing the palette at the right time. And for something like the color computer, it's a fair bit of work because I have to interrupt the program a certain number of times. I think it's something like 6,000 times per second in order to go back and keep up with the video screen so that I can change the colors at the right time, so that I can play the two-channel audio in the background in real time, so that I can do the horizontal scrolling as well. So the game is being interrupted 6,000 times per second.
Wow.
to do all these effects. And I could only really do that if the scrolling was being done for me by using the hardware scroll of the Gimme chip. If I had to write code to do the scrolling, there'd be no time or very little time to do any of the other stuff. So it's very tight, but in the end it worked. I mean, when I started this project, I thought, gee, I don't know if I can do that. I mean, for me, that's about the most complicated hardware feat I've done. So I don't know if I can do it, but oh well, there's only one way to find out. So
yeah, here I am
towards the end of the game, and everything's gone to plan. And the irony is that I've actually got a fair number of CPU cycles left over. I have a test routine. If I press F2 down during the game, I actually have a graphical representation of how much time I'm using up cycle-wise. So I'm holding FD. See the red border? Oops. See the red border?
Yeah.
Right. From the top down, that's how much time I'm using. The area at the bottom, the black area, is how much time I've got left over. So basically, I've still got time to do other things, which I thought I'd be really pushed for. So here I am near the end of the game, and I've still got time left over. So it means I could probably add something in. And one thing I'm working on at the moment is to put an explosion effect for the balloons. At the moment, they just go pop and disappear, because I thought, oh, I won't have enough CPU time, surely. But it looks like I will have, so I'm trying to write a little simple explosion on each balloon, so like a pop explosion effect to go with the pop sound.
Excellent.
Little things like that. I sort of leave till the very end, the final eye candy, and anything else I can add in. Basically, it all depends on how much time I've got left, and also how many bytes I have left. I've allocated 8K for the code. and I'm getting close to it. I'm about 7.5, so I do have enough room there to CPU time left over to add a bit more eye candy. Well, to finish the game for starters, there's a few objects that still aren't finished yet, and to also have enough room there for more code. So it'll be tight. The whole game occupies 64K, which is small, really. Of course, it grabs a bit more for the video buffers, of course. But on the disc, it's 64K of data on there. And the reason for that was originally I had planned maybe to have it on a 64K ROM cartridge, but I'm just thinking, well, what's the point really? Because I've got a CoCo SDC cartridge. I can just put this whole game on the CoCo SDC. It's just like a ROM cartridge, really. If I look down at the color computer, can you see that?
Yeah.
I have a CoCo SDC. It's just like a ROM cartridge. That's where the game is. So I can make the game the size of a floppy disk if I want. So I've moved away from trying to make a ROM cartridge game from it. And by doing that, it means I've now got more memory to play with. I want to make larger levels or add a few more things. But at this stage, this is what I had planned for right at the start. And so far, so good. I'll be happy if I could just get what I've planned for and release it that way. That's it in a nutshell.
Yeah, the picture has cleared up a lot, so it's really nice just to look at it, and it's impressive. Yes. And to me, being the geek that I am, I enjoy hearing some of this backstory to what you've done to make this happen. You know, I like to watch a movie and listen to the director's commentary and all the behind the scenes stuff. You know, so to hear this, to me, this is like a treat to be like kind of on the inside of the process.
In my head, eh?
Yeah, it's really, really cool. I mean, I'm just, and it's cleared up so much now. I can see the explosions now when you're shooting the everything.
Can you see the propeller?
I can't quite see the propeller.
Right.
I see it as a little tiny blurry stick.
Yeah.
It's definitely, the picture has cleared up a lot. It's impressive. It's. And I don't know how to ask you this question without insulting you, but I think somebody who's not a coconut, they're going to probably be thinking to themselves, why would somebody spend this much time and energy dealing with all of these challenges and when you don't have to? Why not pick up a real computer and make a real game, you know?
The easy answer?
We're talking about Nick Marentes.
That's right. That's right. I've got mad written on my T-shirt.
But I'm glad that you are doing this because it's absolutely amazing. I don't think anybody outside of the small circle of insanity would appreciate this, you know?
No, probably not, yeah. It's something I was always doing in the 80s, and it's something I just carry on now. I still do fiddle with other computers, of course, like the Amiga is a big favorite of mine. But to see this Amiga power or Amiga-like power happening on a much lesser machine like the CoCo is what's a challenge. The challenge is not so much to release a game, you know. I mean, really, for what I want, the money I'd get from selling it wouldn't really even be worth it, really. The challenge is in being able to do these things on the color computer, all these extra little hardware tricks and stuff. That's the challenge, trying to make it all work. So far, so good.
Yeah, well, it's incredible. It is absolutely incredible.
Plus, a lot of the programmers back then, I mean, we really wanted to see how far could you push the machine given enough time to learn it properly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
And congratulations, Nick. Good job, as expected.
Thanks.
a few people in the chat have chimed in. So Steve Batson said, incredible. James Ross says, cool game, Nick. Looks like a lot of work going into that. Enjoyed the technical explanation just now. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah.
Certainly read the blog. The blog that I've written has been not so much to cover the technical aspects of the game. It's more to just more to learn the questions and the problems and a lot of the design decisions made to make it happen. I purposely avoided trying to get into too much code examples and stuff. It really is about the design, about the artwork, the creation of the sounds, and the general putting together of the game itself. I mean, there's a lot more to a game than what a lot of people appreciate, actually. It's almost like putting together a movie, isn't it?
It is.
You've got to script it. You've got to work from a script. So the script, of course, is not written. It's all in my head, of course. That's probably all that's in there. But you have this dream, you have this vision. In the case of this game, I started pretty well as a blank slate. I started with the idea that I would do something that was something like Scramble. I didn't really know where it was going to go, but I just knew I wanted to do something like Scramble. But by the same token, I didn't want to do a copy of Scramble either. I've always tended to try it. Most of my games are originals in that I try to come up with my own ideas. So I use Scramble as a catalyst, and then I twist it from there. And hopefully in the end, I end up with a game which can be called original.
Yeah, it seems like it so far from what we've seen here.
It's a new idea. I've taken away a lot of the stuff that you do find in Scramble, and I've tried to make it family-friendly by just having it so that you pop balloons largely.
Right.
Megan try it when it's done there, Steve.
Yeah, my 7-year-old daughter will love this.
Hopefully she'll like this game, yeah.
If you look at all the crap she plays on her tablets, I mean, this is something good for a change.
My grandson would love this.
Yeah.
Of course, you can tell them, you know, this is all running on a 30-year-old 2 megahertz computer. Of course, their eyes will roll. They won't understand why you're so excited by that. But, well, for me, it makes me excited.
Time I get something from eBay, my wife's like, oh, yeah, something else from the Flintstone era just came in.
Well, I've got the same problem, Steve. I just actually ordered a Tandy 2001 Model 102 from eBay tonight.
Oh, wow.
Oh, you'll have to play my old Model 1 games then.
And one of these days, I have to find room for this stuff. I don't have room for anything. But I've never owned a Model 1 or 3, but I think I can finally afford one now, thankfully. So one day I will have one. So they were quite expensive when they were new.
Well, that's about all of it, unless someone's got any questions or anything.
No, I'm just sitting here staring at the screen. I could just stare at the screen all day. You know, it's like this a good game. It has so many things about it that you could just watch it and not even play it, you know. And I'm just sitting here looking at these screens. Well, absolutely amazing.
Interestingly enough, I hardly play games, really. I spend more time doing exactly that, just looking at them. And in particular, the old games. Because I knew that there was limitations. And it's always good to see what the programmer, what the designer has done with so little. I can fire up a PC. I can fire up a modern PC and look at some of the latest 3D graphics. But I think to myself, hang on a second, these things are running at 2 to 3 gigahertz, and probably have an entire team of artists and programmers.
Oh yeah, yeah. I was gonna mention that. You mentioned that you're doing this all by yourself.
This is a one man show.
Yeah, yeah. In the modern video game, like you mentioned, it is like producing a movie. You have somebody write the story. You have concept artists that do the concept art. You have a team of modelers, a team of animators. I mean, I've worked for visual effects production, so I know the different disciplines that go into it. It's insane. You know?
And each person is a specialized in that field.
Yes.
When you're creating your own game, you have to become a specialist in all those yourself.
You were an artist, you were a scientist, you were everything. A graphics person, you were a musician, you were a sound designer.
You're everything.
And that's
half the excitement, really. It's a shame that that's gone. Although you do see that to a degree with some of these small iPhone games. Some of those are done by a smaller group.
Like an indie
game. Yeah, that's right. So you like just double back game on the iPhone. Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah, so you still can get it, but you know, most kids nowadays they want, you know, the latest and the greatest that's had millions of dollars thrown into it to create it. It's got to be realistic.
Yeah, like, yeah, I mean, you know what blows my mind right now is that Arnold Schwarzenegger is doing commercials for an app.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? It's just like, what does this world come to?
That's right.
I know. It's a bloody app.
But still, I think Nick was one of the original programmers for the CoCo.
I guess I am. I still do program everything in a very retro fashion. I mean, as you can see, I'll just move it out of. Oops. I still have. I'll just move the camera back a bit.
Okay, let me get you full screen again then.
There we are. So a bit more back. So basically, that's my entire CoCo 3. It's just a basic CoCo 3 with 512K. There's no multi-pack, no hard drives or anything fancy.
Right.
Just a CoCo SDC card.
Okay.
An RGB monitor, and that's it. If I need to design any graphics, I'll create it on the Amiga, just on the left of it.
Okay.
So I keep it retro. I use a 25-year-old computer to create graphics for a 30-year-old computer. I mean, that's
like I said, Nick, you're the original.
That's amazing. Right, that's,
and I'm older than 30, so I mean, this is basically my retro corner. You know,
that's amazing.
I don't use the PC much for development. I do use the PC for transferring of files. So files from the Amiga, go onto a floppy, which I read on the PC, and then on the PC I mount them into DriveWire for the color computer. So I sort of use the PC that way. I do also use the PC. Sometimes it's handy to have a full screen editor, so I'll just whack up something in Word, say, if I'm working on a piece of code, I'll do it in Word where I've got a full screen, mouse-driven, I can scroll things, cut and paste much easier, just to work out the routine. But then I'll go back to the color computer and run Robert Galt's old assembler and just do the rest of the work on the color computer. If I reset it, whoops, hang on. The beauty is that I can just go straight to the assembler like so. I don't know if you can see that at all.
Yeah, I see it.
Assembler is booted. Now I can load my source code. Okay, I've hit enter. Now it takes less than a minute, and all the source code for the code you saw will load in. And I'll bring it up and scroll it when it's loaded. So it takes a little while because it's near the it's almost 8K of code. So it's near the end of the project. So the source code is quite large now.
Actually, John, I was going to ask John Strong there. Do you develop on the CoCo itself, like the actual assembly and stuff, or do you do cross like they do on some of the Nickolas Marentes projects?
Well, it's kind of a combination. I actually do on the emulator on the CoCo for all the assembly stuff. I use ECTAS, and so if I need to single step or something, I can with the debugger.
It's loaded now, yeah.
And but I do a lot of my editing on the PC with a special app that I built just to handle the code. So it's a similar process, and something I'm doing on the PC doesn't really require a fast PC. You know, it could be old. In fact, I do have a powerful processor, but you know, the speed on the PC for what I do there doesn't make a difference. I mean, you got to run it on an old laptop. But it's assembled in ETASM, okay? I really need to invest in Roberts so I can do 6309, but I haven't done that yet.
As you can see, it's scrolling forever. I mean, there's nothing wrong with doing the way John does it. He does some great work there and just uses a PC more. I'm also, apart from trying to create a new game, I'm also trying to relive the good old days, you know, so do things the old way, the way I used to do it in the 80s. So this is all old school.
Oh, it is, but it was the old school was the best school. Because the new school now, they're teaching that Common Core crap.
kids have it so easy nowadays.
amazing. This is the source code to Popstar Pilot we're looking at right now.
Scrolling away, that's how long it is.
I almost thought I was looking into the Matrix.
And then the reason for mine doing it that way is the fact that for a long time, I had moved and stuff, and my CoCo was storage, so... To be able to do it, I had to move to the emulator, and not enough space to put things up. You still don't really have enough, you know. But you know, it's
still going. Know,
CoCo's cool.
I think I would get lost in that code. I mean, my mind is blown just watching that thing scroll like it is right now.
Just gonna
do a line. It's art in itself of being able to handle large amounts of code. And not get lost in it. And I worked at a place and somebody was criticizing me behind the back. And I left and came back and the guy looked at the stuff. He says, "How did you handle all that stuff?" He actually had to look at the stuff I worked with. So, you know, this is a skill. And there's not a lot of us that's still around and still doing this from the day. And Nick's doing it. You know, I'm still doing it. Yeah.
What do people who make modern like PC and console games write in? Do they write in like C or something else? Is assembly a lost language in a sense too? Or
I guess they'd use C or some high level language. I mean, remember computers nowadays run at 2 to 3 gigahertz. I mean, why would you need assembler except if you want to really optimize a section of the code nowadays? You know.
It's a high-level language, except for maybe the shaders, which might be done on a level shading language.
That's right, yeah. But back when you only have less than 2 megahertz to play with, you didn't have too much choice, really. It depends on the game as well. No. So it depends on what you're programming. I mean, you can do a board game in BASIC. It's still quite good. Certainly... this sort of game can't be done in BASIC. Most arcade games of the era were all assembler anyway, so they needed the extra speed to get even arcade Pac-Man to work, or Space Invaders.
Right.
Well, actually, most of the arcade games were written in assembler.
Well, that's right. Yeah, that's right. I don't know what they use nowadays, but
what else would there have been, really? Because these were custom built machines too. It wasn't like there was a development kit you could just pick up off the shelf and.
That's right. So if you could buy a basic pack for your Pac-Man machine, hey.
this was a treat though. It really was.
Anyway,
I know we didn't. This was definitely a treat just to hear and watch the game and to hear about the process.
World preview, eh?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. To see an actual preview to Popstar is actually kind of cool.
Yeah. Absolutely.
The next blog page should be up in about a week or two. I'm just working on the balloon popping routine. So once I get that done, I'll do the next blog update.
I'm going to have to start reading those too. I guess I'm kind of new to some of these things. Like I never listened to a podcast before. It was the CoCo Crew was the first podcast I listened to. And so that's a new experience for me of only a few months. And so now reading blogs, something I've never done, but I'm going to start reading blogs now too. I'm going to learn all kinds of new bad habits and hobbies.
Have a look. There's a few good blogs. I mean, the John Strong has one and John, John. Yep, he has a great blog. I've tended to keep away from my blog being too technical, so hopefully you might follow it okay. You might even get a laugh out of some of the bad humor.
Good.
Any other time?
Speaking of bad humor, I've got all kinds in the manual for Bomb Squad. Inside joke to the backstory game, of it. So
all right.
You guys will enjoy that, you know.
Okay.
So, Nick, are you going to be attending CoCo Fest?
It's a bit of a long flight. I remember the last two times I did, it was like a 20-hour flight just to get there. I was pretty buggered to start with.
Yeah.
I was very buggered by the end of it.
I can
imagine. It was worth it, though. It was worth it. I saw a lot of the CoCo luminaries. That's where I met Curtis Boyle as well. And didn't we have the
John
creator?
Kowalski was there.
John was there too. That's right. But we also had those people who worked at Microware who did the basic
as
well.
Yeah, Mark Wilkins was there, one of the guys.
Yeah, Mark Wilkins was there. The programmer for Xenix was there, and Jeremy
Spiller. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So yeah, we had a few good people there, which it made it worth the flight.
Yeah, I mean, the power of technology we have now, the fact that we can all be on this call together and be looking at this stuff and talking about this stuff, it's absolutely amazing.
Maybe this is the future of CoCo Fest.
You know, it would not be a bad thing to extend it to, because, you know, even for me, you know, I had to wait to make sure I had the money for that. And I'm in the same country. But, you know, not everybody can just pull out the hotel and the airfare and all these kind of things and the work plan. So... I'm sure there's a lot of people who want to and for, you know, various reasons can't. So some type of teleconference extension to it, you know, using technology would probably be a great extension.
That's right.
And so I don't know if that's already in the works. I had inquired about maybe doing some live streaming from the event, and the people I've spoken to says that you know, that's probably a good idea. So I'm thinking about just bringing my laptop and having a camera on the laptop as long as there's Wi-Fi, and just stream, you know, anybody who walks by, just to, you know, kind of capture what's going on.
Yeah, and there has been some of that at some of the previous CoCo Fest the last few years, but hotel bandwidth isn't always the greatest thing.
Okay. Yeah, I can imagine that being a limitation.
But also, on the same line there, I was just going to ask John and Nick, so when are you guys going to write a video streamer for the CoCo that, you know, a CoCo user could use to watch the fest?
I think John Lindley is about halfway there, isn't he?
Oh, he's got his video audio player. Yeah, he's actually, you know, digitized Star Wars, the entire movie.
Wow.
Plays it on the CoCo.
That's impressive.
Yeah, you'll see that at the fest. John's bringing it. When I heard. So.
But this is a good thing to add to it. You know, the fest. You know, I work remotely out of the house, and you know, these meetings on the computer are nice, but and they're good. It just doesn't replace, you know, being walking, somebody shake their hands, see it face to face. It's just a little bit different. So I think they both have their places, and they can complement each other.
Yeah,
I can agree with that too.
Colby Cooley just joined us and says hello. Hello, Colby.
Hello, Colby.
I'm going to try to bring up another Nick Marentes game here. I'm going to see if I can bring up Rupert Rhythm on the emulator. I'm not sure if it's going to work. And or should I? I don't know what else I have. Yeah. To bring up Rupert Rhythm, how would I launch this now? My emulator just died.
There's a fast program on there, I think, that you just run.
Yeah,
through.
I think I'm going to just abandon all hopes in running an emulator right now. So we'll just keep it here. This was good, though. I enjoyed this. And we've been streaming now for almost an hour and a half. And for me, I could do this for 48 hours a day, and it wouldn't be enough. But maybe for the people who are part of this and people are watching it, maybe we can go ahead and take a break or wrap it up. But I definitely enjoyed it. This just seeing Popstar Pilot was worth it. Being able to play Bomb Squad was a treat. I'm sure we can do this again for sure. I'd like to do this more often.
You didn't get the preview of Dr. Mario type
guy. Let me try it, because I just tried. Let me try that. Hold on one second. Let me do that one more, because I'm blaming it on my computer, but I need to go to Drive Zero. And this is a cartridge, right? So I can do it as a ROM. Okay.
Yes.
So let me try that. So let's go to
And again, I feel humbled after coming before and after Nick. So.
So, I might switch my video off. It might buy a bit more bandwidth for you.
Okay, no worries. No worries. Let's see if I can get that up. Okay, so that's a ROM. So now I need to change my multipack. Switch my multipack to slot one. And then we'll see what happens here. Okay, Colby Cooley says I subscribe. Thank you, Colby. I'm moving this back down. I might need to reboot my machine now. Here we go. Okay, I think I've got Dr. Mario up.
Okay, and just use your arrow keys on your keyboard is probably the best way to do this.
Okay, and now what do I do here? Do I change this to dynamic view to whoever's speaking in? If anybody wants to go back into the stream, that's fine. If you want to turn your cameras on, I think we'll be fine. Okay, so I'm looking at a couple of clipboards. You're saying use my arrow keys?
Yeah.
Okay, and what is this, like a Tetris?
No, this is like a Dr. Mario.
And I'm not that familiar with the game. So.
Okay, line up the pills on top of the colors on top of the viruses.
On top of the viruses,
well,
okay.
No, the viruses. It's three in a row. Okay. Or four in a row in the color, and they disappear.
Okay, well, I'm probably going to have to start over.
It looks like I
screwed this pooch.
Well, this is definitely, you know, pre-release version.
I have, yes. So,
try Q for quit.
Yeah, how do I start over? Q for quit? All right.
Yeah.
Hold on, let me click back on here. So this is okay, game over. There we go. So this is an early preview of what is it going to be called on the CoCo now?
Probably Doctor.
Doctor.
Unless I come up with a better name in the meantime.
Okay. Okay. Doctor, give me the news. Okay, so tell me again what I'm supposed to do here.
Okay, yeah, you can rotate it. Drop that red on top of the red virus.
On top of the red virus.
Yeah. Here, you just want to get that off the side, please.
So I need to get red pills on top of red viruses?
Yes.
Even if it's only half red?
Yes.
And how many do you have to stack up?
It's going to be four.
Oh, I see. Okay, I'm slowly but surely figuring this out.
Isn't this something like a Dr. No? John?
It's a Dr. Mario type game.
Okay. I thought I remember Dr. No name.
I wasn't familiar with that.
Okay. So there is kind of like a columns element too, where if you just get enough colors stacked up.
Yeah, it's there. The idea is to get rid of the viruses in this case. You know.
Okay. And so since I have already screwed that up, that virus is now kind of... its own defense system going on there.
Right, and you have to pack them and remove the thing. But drop that right on there, you see that. So you drop the on, you could do that. Drop that, rotate that, drop the green, so that's going to drop it down. Drop that, yeah, okay?
Okay.
So if you mess it up, then you have to work around it to delete out what's there.
Okay. I like it though. Okay, Colby's back. Hello, welcome back, Colby. Very cool. I like it. I like these types of games. Okay, so now hopefully I can get this booger. I got him. Ah, there you go. I'm slow, but I'm steady. I'm an old dog, but I can learn a new trick. So very cool. Okay, so now I have a solid green capsule. We want to get four greenies. I'm screwing up here. Another greenie. There we go. Now I gotta try to get rid of that red that I screwed up over there. This is cool. I like it.
Nothing to the programming effort or anything it's doing in a pop sword pilot. It's still a fun game.
Oh, yeah. A game is a game. You know what I mean? It's just, if it's fun, it's fun.
And that's it, you know. So I've got to admire the work in next.
Oh, yeah. This is cool. I like the sound effects too. And I am noticing the stereo panning in my headphones.
Yeah. Again, Orchestra Mining support.
Yeah, you're one of the few that does that for games.
And Orchestra 90 is the one of the few things that all the emulators can handle.
Yes.
Which I have asked why we have not emulated Speech Sound Pack. I think I've gotten somewhat of an answer. But it still doesn't help my cause selfish reasons.
The Orchestra 90 is pretty easy because it's just two 8-bit DACs. It's basically just two 8-bit channels.
And I did order in some of the chips in. They were a little hard to find, but I found them now. You could add that to a cartridge pretty cheap nowadays.
Yeah.
Do you have an expected
release date for this, John?
For this? No, I don't. I've got... got to find time to work on it. I'm trying to get the other stuff for the fastest stuff out. And I'm just trying to make the experience in Bomb Squad to be just unique. Yeah, it's not that super special game with the other, but I want it to be the best done. So I've been working on the experience on that to make it unique. And so a lot of the things are not getting looked at now. In fact, I have the Gem 2 is running on cartridge right now. I've got to get out of the way till I get the Bomb Squad release before I get time to sit down and do the manuals. And
Bomb Squad will be available at CoCo Fest, correct?
At CoCo Fest or before.
Okay. I am looking forward to owning a copy. Maybe if you can put in a good word with me with the author, maybe I can get an autograph copy even.
Oh, I think that's doable.
It helps to know people.
Put me on that one too, Steve.
I don't like to throw my weight around, but there's plenty of it, so. Oh my goodness. This is fun. I like games like this. This is very much a nostalgic game.
Well, and that's kind of the thing. It is. It's there. It's in the style. And I wonder how much to imitate of the original and what not to. And you know, how much can I do? In the case of Nintendo decides, somebody from Nintendo sees it. You know, will they complain or not complain? You know. And so it's.
It's hard to say what games are truly original because there's so much inspiration in everything.
Well, is it, you know, again, this, you know, the design of it's not original. I'm not claiming that, okay?
The
code behind it, though, and there's a lot of, you know, complicated logic going in making sure those things disappear properly and your combos go, and they go sideways, they go up like they're supposed to, and you know, so as you play it, the gameplay is basically there, okay? It plays smooth. It doesn't crash. I just got to do all the
Yeah, no, it's up. Impressive. It looks good. It feels good. It sounds good. It's a fun, playable game. I'm going to try it one more time because I am just a glutton for fun games. I like it. I never played Dr. Mario, and so now I have an appreciation for that game.
You can find it on MAME, too, if you want to try the original arcade version.
Yeah.
I played the original.
Okay.
And then Soviet block, it's a Tetris clone, basically. But,
right.
You know, I modeled it after the arcade and the Nintendo game systems, not the PC. And so it has the smoothness to pick the play that a lot of the other Tetris games don't, because they modeled one after the wrong versions. It didn't have the really smooth play that you could, it just seems I've just done, you know, a lot of puzzle games. Now I can't do something else. It's just you've got code sitting there that I can repurpose and reuse, and just seems to be okay. I want to do this. Well, I got a lot of background code for this, so I just do it instead of doing something else.
Yeah. Well, what I like about this is that for me, video games are kind of like my drugs and alcohol. When I want to relax or unwind or entertain myself or loosen up, That's what I do. And some games, you know, when I'm wanting to relax, there are certain games that just stress the hell out of me. And I'm like, why am I playing this game when I'm trying to relax? And you get into a casual game like this, and you can actually just do that. You can relax. You can just have fun. Not worried about an overly difficult game that some evil person made that, you know, designed for humans to never beat. You know, they're games that are just fun, challenging, and rewarding. And, you know, this definitely fits that bill. And it's a fun little game to play. I like it. And so we're seeing another preview. This is two previews in one night. This is like, you know, this is an exclusive. I should have TMZ on this Skype call.
Well, you've got three previews, two previews from me, a preview from Nick.
Yes.
Yeah, right.
I like it. So we looked at Bomb Squad. We're looking at Doc. The working title now is Doc Doc.
Yeah, Doctor Doctor is my working. That's a working title. What it will be in the end, I don't know, but.
And Popstar Pilot as well.
Popstar Pilot. Yep. I could probably die and go. You know, I could die a happy person at this point. You know. I have seen.
You can't I've do that, though, because there's a lot more videos to make.
Yeah, I've seen The Promised Land, and it is good.
Oh, you guys, you want to hear the inside humor from my backstory for Bomb Squad?
Oh, yes, please.
Okay, let's see what we do now. It says, welcome, Officer Candy, to the CoCo Beach Bomb Squad. Looking at the results of your physical exam, I see that you have all your party parts. Good, that means you are careful and lucky. In this job, you need both characteristics, since you are replacing No-Toe Sam on our Mind Search and Disarm team.
You're replacing who? I lost you for a second.
No-Toe Sam.
No-Toes?
Yeah.
Okay.
As you know, they know CoCo Beach has a psycho on the loose, planting mines all over the city. He's using a rather nasty mesh network mine known as the Z-80. All the mines in the local mesh network have to be found before any can be disarmed. Unfortunately, the department has the best countermeasure danger available for the Z-80, the mine counter 68 version 09.
6809.
Okay, and the FC-6809. The FC-6809 detects and scans the Z-80's network, instantly counting the number of mines at the minefield site. However, this triggers the Z-80's self-destruction timer. You will have to race against time to disarm the mines. And our MC-6809 mine detector system was recently upgraded to a high-resolution detection system developed by engineering team Nickolas Marentes and Boyle.
Ah, there you go. We have some CoCo names in there. Oh, crap. I almost had that dude. Dang it. That's funny. You got processor references in there. You've got programmer references in there.
You got Tandy Corporation.
Yeah.
So it's a little funny. You get inside humor in there.
Yeah. No, I dig it. I need to kill this bloody blue bug for the life of me. You need to die, bug. Will I kill the bug? No, I'm not going to kill this bug. This is fun, though. I like it. Fun game.
And this is one game I've never seen for the color computer other than mine.
I'm surviving, but I'm not thriving in this game here. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and, you know, the Columns game, I've never seen another one.
Yeah, no, I like that. I played, I think, what did I play today? Gems 1? I think I did a preview of Gems 1.
Yeah.
All right. Very, very cool. I like it. I like it a lot. I like the sounds. I like the play. It's beautiful.
And, you know, and it's a different style of what Nick is doing. You know, they're both really good. I got to say, I admire what he's doing.
Oh, yeah, me too. I admire what all you guys are doing because I can't do it. But I'm a game player, you know. Mm-hmm. And so for me, a person who plays games, I'm delighted that people are making them. And I certainly appreciate any and all games. And so, you know, this is great. This is great. There's definitely a level of talent that has to come into this. There's the technical talent. There's the imagination part of it. There's the the execution. I think one of the things that both of you have touched on too is the time, because this isn't your job. This is, for lack of a better term, this is a side project that you're doing in between your regular life, right? So you got other things going on and you're still managing to squeeze in the time to do these things and produce them. So I appreciate it, and I'm looking forward to playing more of these. You know, this is awesome. So very cool. You want me to pull up another game? Is there another one I should pull up right now?
If you want to do one more, Nick's maybe.
Okay, is Nick still with us?
Yep, still here.
Okay. So
you have Space Intruders, I guess, could be one. Rupert Rhythm.
Rupert Rhythm, you can try. Yeah, it's my least favorite game.
Is it really?
I hated the game.
Okay. Well, let me reboot my VCC here and see how well I can get this thing going here. I might have to. I'm actually gonna have to probably relaunch the app. Yep. Windows.
So, Nick, do you hate it just because I know you've mentioned in the past that there was a few parts of the game you wish you'd change, like have the elevators go to where you are rather than this fixed cycle?
Yeah.
Is it just stuff like that, or do you just not like the game after you were done, period?
Yeah, it's mainly that. It was my first it was my first CoCo 3 game as such, so I guess you learn as you go. So soon after finishing it, I felt like, oh, I could have done that better, I could have done this better, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, I was on a deadline. I had to get it out in time. That was actually sold by Radio Shack here, so I had to get it out quickly. So,
and that was your best-selling one too, wasn't it?
No, Donut Dilemma was.
Oh, okay.
How about I play that one? Because I can't get Rupert to work. I don't see anything in the dir when I type in dir.
Ah.
So, or I'll take another suggestion here since I don't know all the titles.
Space Intruders, if you have that one.
Okay.
What other ones did you have there, Nick?
Well, CoCo 3 ones. I think we pretty well covered them all.
Space Intruder. Let me see if I can find that one.
It's a Space Invaders. That was my first non-original game.
I think I found it. Let's see how well it plays.
You also added an element of Phoenix to it at the end. There's a big mothership.
Yeah, there is an actual end to it, unlike our original Space Invaders. It just kept seeing wave upon wave of aliens. It never reached the end. But in Space Intruders, there is. Level 9, a big flying saucer comes down. I don't know if anyone has seen it, but you have. So there is a bit more to it. This is do the normal game, I guess.
Normal game? Is that N for normal?
I can't remember what custom did. That wasn't my hack.
Okay. Space Intruders. Ah, I like the space reminds me of the Space Invaders logo. Okay, so we will do J for joysticks. And so far I'm liking everything that... Oh, look at these guys here. This is cute. Oh, the digital sound effects are incredible. It does look like a mix of a couple different platforms. So the lower level bugs with their kind of green eyes remind me of Galaga bugs. The middle level are kind of like bats or something, and then the top level are kind of invader-ish. But they looks like a variety of inspiration went into some of these character models.
They're all modeled on the original graphics. They're just spruced up a bit, really. They have the same general look of the original.
Okay. I like them. Okay, well, I did very, very horribly. Okay.
I should mention, Steve, too, if you want to see what the mothership looks like, I actually have a shot of it on the webpage.
Okay. All right, I'm going to try it again. I'm going to pay attention to the game. The sound effects are amazing. I like that.
Yeah, that is one place where I definitely say I lack on. I mean, I guess my sound effects are okay, but background music I really haven't done.
So does anybody here in the panel write current entertainment software for platforms from the 21st century? Or are we all still doing retro stuff?
Well, actually, Steve, now that you mention it, I'm actually working on a sound generator for YM3812 with a CoCo.
Okay.
Seeing if that's going to actually work.
Is that is that a Yamaha chipset?
Yep. It's actually the original Ad Lib.
Oh, neato. Neato.
Yeah.
Steve Batson says, I like this one better than the blurring black and white Space Invaders.
Yeah.
Okay.
But then we're actually going to see if that works and
okay.
See what happens.
So you understand how to do hardware type stuff?
Yes.
So can you help me understand what are some of the challenges of making a speech sound pack clone?
Well, that depends on whether you want to keep it compatible with CoCo 3 or CoCo in general.
Yeah, well, that would be my desire. And again, my reasons are purely my own selfish ones. I would like a speech sound pack cloned into a CoCo SDC so I could play everything and not have to buy a multi-pack. But since that hasn't happened yet, I've now been able to buy both of those components. I have a multi-pack on the way, and I have a speech sound pack. But again, I've got limited space. So for me to have all that stuff hooked up is a challenge, too.
Yeah.
So I might be one of five people who think that's a cool thing to have. But I would be perfectly happy just playing all the original games with the compatibility of the original speech sound pack, you know?
Yep. Well, of course. And we'll see what we can do.
Yeah. So again, these are my own selfish reasons. Because exactly. I believe somebody has mentioned, well, why do you want to make something that nobody's going to write for? And I was like, well, don't make something new. Just make the old one work. You know. So because the stuff's already written. There's two dozen games that will take advantage of the speech sound pack. You know.
Exactly. But right now you can't get the hardware anymore. So.
Somebody would have to get a hold of the hardware to reverse engineer it, I guess?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, but I actually have what I need, so.
Okay, Nick just asked Curtis if you could send me Rupert Rhythm in the chat. This is cool. This is cool. I have an image of it, but the image doesn't seem to work. This is cool, though.
Check if I got.
I like this game. I like the colors. I like the sounds. I don't like the fact that I suck at it. Yeah, your ship is very wide. So it definitely makes you a lot more exposed to the enemies. And the enemies start off pretty low to the ground, too. So I know people had different strategies for Space Invaders. Some people like to take out columns versus rows. But I almost think you might have to take out that bottom row just to free up some space with these boogers. Because they are maximizing the playing field to their advantage, not to mine. But yeah, it's very playable. The colors are great. Sound effects are great. I like it a lot.
I have no idea if this is a working copy.
He says, I'm in the mood to bag myself. Bring on Rupert. That is so funny.
Yeah, unfortunately, the original computer that I transferred a lot of the disk images to when I was doing the website died, and I haven't redone the disk images from stuff I already had done on the website. So I just sent you one. I don't know if it works. It might be the same buggered up copy you've got. I don't know.
Okay. Well, I'll take a look at my email. I'll let this run. Let me just try this one more time because I'm hell-bent on clearing one wave of this bloody game here, which I'm not doing very good at so far.
Yeah, you're supposed to clear the ships on the top, not the bottom.
And I will say, you know, guys are talking about hardware for the, you know, game cartridges. And, you know, I, for one, if the cost is low enough that it can be included in each game, I'd be up for writing software for it.
Yeah, oh, really? Oh, that's good. That there are current people who would want to support it, sure. Again, yeah. It's hard to get into the mentality of a collective consciousness, but my own selfish reasons would make me wish I had one that was easy for me to utilize and record videos from. Let me check my email real quick and see if I got this thing from Nick. And yeah, my email is ogstevystrow.
Yeah, before you get to the rhythm there, Steve, if you want to just hit my webpage, you can take a look at the mothership for Space Intruders. Since you have
okay, let's do that. Let's do that real quick. Let's pull up Curtis's website. Good one. Let me get to Curtis's site. I need to create. Okay, yeah. Let's watch the game over mode because the computer will do better than I will. Let's go to your color computer game page, and we're gonna go to what is it? It is called Space Intruders. So I gotta go to S's. I'm sure people enjoy hearing me think out loud here. I'm a slow thinker. Okay, here we go. Let's do that. Oh, there's the big mothership. That's cool. Let me stretch this out a little bit. Okay, and let me add this as a screenshot. Let's do a quick screen capture, and I will get that on here. So here we have it, folks. This is from Curtis Boyle's Game List website. And what we're looking at here is the opening logo of Space Intruders. We're looking at the gameplay. We're looking at the high score entry screen. And then we're looking at the giant mothership that I will never make it to in my lifetime.
And it's basically like Phoenix. You got to blast through it to hit the alien.
Oh, I see that. It's got, and is it scrolling too? Is it like a scrolling force field or?
Yeah, I believe the middle part scrolls, doesn't it, Nick? I've played it once.
Very cool. That's cool. It's nice to see something with a twist, you know? Yeah, so that's probably the best way for me to see some of these levels is to go to your website, Curtis. Oh, Nick says I can't see it. That's Pop Soda sound effect for Popstar Pilot. Popstar Pilot. Yeah, I was trying to see if I... Yeah, that's cool, though. I like it. So, I don't remember. Let me put it in the chat, Nick, just in case you didn't get it. Yeah, I just put my email in the chat in the YouTube channel.
So did you get all the right. Reaper Rhythm copy I sent, just in case
I gotta check my email. Give me just 2 seconds here. I'm trying to multitask, which is dangerous. I have a hard time single-tasking. God bless you.
That was me.
Okay. God bless you. Okay, so here's Rupert 1 zip. Let's just change this to Rupert. R-U-P-E-R-T. Did I spell that right? R-U-P-E-R-T?
Yep.
Okay. Spelling is a secondary skill. Let's get into here.
It's interesting you say that because Rhythm is actually incorrectly spelt right from the start when I released the game. People thought that's how we spell it in Australia. It's not. It was my spelling mistake right from the start.
I think I remember reading that. I think I read that on your website, and then you told them that that was just the guy's name or something like that. You had some crafty...
I made up some excuse. Yes.
Actually, it looks like I have it on my website, too, the Rupert Zip. Is that the one you... I forgot it was on there.
Okay, I'm not exactly sure, but I'm going to re-extract it right now. And then let's see if I can find the Rupert folder. All right, let me see if I can bring it up in my CoCo emulator. If I'm not mistaken, I believe this is one that Neil Blanchard mentioned in one of the CoCo Crew podcasts.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, he did.
With all the
right after a bottle of vodka, because he said it was great.
Okay, here we go. I have actual files now that I can list, and I can. You don't run Bass; you run Rupert.
Right after a bottle of vodka, because he said it was great.
Okay. Loading. Please wait. Now, he did talk about how it used a lot of digital music and everything else, so, or digital sound.
This one I can say I've never gotten to the end where you get the concert. So.
Okay, should I choose America or Australia?
America.
Does that just have to do with PAL or NSTC?
Yeah.
Okay, RGB. I thought maybe I'd get like a wallaby or a kangaroo or something if I chose that. So, the music box caper. Press. Oh, yeah, I hear the music. Let me do this. I'm going to adjust my sound mix so this will come through louder in the stream. Yeah, I hear that. I like it. Okay, let me find my joystick. I have my hands full here. press the joystick button to start. And please don't fail me now, color computer. Yeah, this is my problem right now. My joystick button is not being recognized. Okay, so I cannot press my joystick. Okay, I just press spacebar. Okay, here we go. All right. So am I able to move with the joystick? I am not. I'm not sure what keys I need to press then. Another emulator problem right now. I can't control anything.
Yeah, your character should be moving left and right with the arrow keys.
Okay, that's not working. And if I try to change my configuration now,
Actually, is it frozen? I don't see the elevators moving either.
It's not an OS 9 program, so it shouldn't.
We'll try it again. All right, I'm going to have to cold boot the machine, but let's try it one more time. I've changed my emulation to use the keyboard instead of the joystick, so give me two more seconds here.
Yeah, Steve, we might have to see if the latest version of MES that Eric worked with, maybe it's a bit smoother now.
Did MES support the CoCo 3 and the Gimme chip?
Oh, yeah, it was the first one to support the 639, the first one to support a lot of the hardware, the first one to support the better artifacting.
Oh, wow. I'm going to need you to give me a tutorial on how to install and use MES because I could never get it off the ground.
Actually, MES is a good one.
Yeah. I tried it once or twice. I think I could get it to boot up BASIC, but then I could never figure out how to load an image on it.
Well, the thing is, everything's redefinable, and you can redefine all the keys. So if you have a setup file that changes the keys on it, even the documentation won't be right because you've changed it to whatever. So it's very customizable, which is both a curse and a blessing.
Okay, yeah, I think it's just freezing because, yeah, nothing's moving now.
Okay,
bummer.
VCC problem. Are you running VCC 2?
No, this is the 142 because the 2, when I try to use the 2 when I type it, it doubles up the keys. I can try VCC 2.0 again, but I haven't had good luck with that, and I just haven't had a chance to figure out why. Let me try that real quick. So the keyboard still, right now keyboard says BASIC and not OS 9, but let me just see what I can do here. I'm going to go back, CoCo ROMs, I'm going to go to R for Rupert. I have Rupert. See, when I type in dir, I don't see anything. That's my other problem, is that I go to my MPI config. I'm in slot 4, which is my FD502. I went to cartridge, I went to FD502 drive 0, and I'm trying to insert a disk image, and nothing's happening here.
If you type in star DSK for the file name, does it bring up?
FD502 drive 0.
Yeah, no, I can't. This is my other problem. I couldn't get VCC 2.2. whatever to work either. So, all right. So I think I'm gonna.
We'll save that one for later.
Throw in the towel on that one. Yeah, I do need to work out some of my technical glitches to get my real CoCo into a live situation, which is just not easy to do right now. All right. Well, I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna stop playing. We don't have to stop talking, but I think I'm gonna stop playing because I don't want to sit here and keep futzing with things that are beyond my control. But this is cool. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed looking at John's stuff. I enjoyed looking at Nick's stuff. Enjoyed chatting with all you gentlemen. And feel free to, you know, I don't mind continuing the discussion, but I think I'm going to stop trying to play the games because it looks like I keep hitting some obstacles.
I'll try to work
those out later offline.
Yeah, Nick, it's good to hear from you again. I think the last time I actually talked to you was back in Penfest.
That's right. So, yes, I remember that.
Yeah, so it's been a long time. We've done some emails, but as far as, you know, voice talk in there. And Curtis, it's been a long time since we've actually talked to you again.
Yeah, I think the last CoCo Fest in Chicago I was at, which has got to be at least 10, 12, 13 years now.
Yeah, it's been a while. and Bill and everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. It's for you, a pleasure. Too?
Yeah, my pleasure too.
And I must say, it is an honor to be able to speak to all of you and hear all your stories and look at your hard work. And I appreciate, I'm still that kid who likes to play games. I'm just now pushing 50 years old, but I'm still that kid who likes to play. And I appreciate people who are creating content for me to consume to entertain my childlike mind.
Yeah, so, well, Steve, I'm the same age, so don't worry.
Yeah, sometimes if I look at myself from the eyes of an outsider, I wonder how can a grown man still be so adamant about playing games, you know?
Just call it a hobby, then you're fine.
Yeah, exactly. It is an obsession. It is a way of life. It is an addiction. It is all of these things. So. Steve Batson says ditto. All right. Well, I guess we can go ahead and wrap this up. This was again fun. This is like these are like the warm ups to CoCo Fest. You know, this is like the opening acts.
All right. Well, thanks for hosting everything tonight. It's been really good.
Yeah, I really enjoyed Popstar Pilot. That's
I've got to make a run for it. So
yeah, thank you, Nick.
It's good to see John's stuff, and thanks to Curtis and everyone there for helping me along and. Yeah, keep an eye out for the next blog.
I'm going to do that. Time.
All right, then. There we go.
Thank you all. For those of you who are watching on YouTube, thank you for watching. And CoCo forever. Long live the CoCo and all that good stuff. And we'll see you at CoCo Fest.
See you, lads.
See ya.